So thank you all for all of the presentations today. I feel like there's a lot that we are, every time we, I think, meet and talk to those who are working on the ground, we learn so much about the different issues and also where there's confusion. I think echoing Jana's point that what one thing I think that we haven't discussed is beyond looking at just the state rules and implementation around the law, what else is needed from the government to really address the causes and drivers of child marriage, and also what can be done alongside rules and implementation to ensure a rights-based approach is taken, not only for girls who are leaving child marriages, but also those who stay within child marriages. And from the perspective of reproductive rights, there are about three major areas, I think, where we could be seeking a little bit more either convergence of the WCD with other departments, or where there are other initiatives that would be really useful. And you know, we know with reproductive rights that they are really essential to ending child marriage. Ensuring sexual and reproductive rights is crucial because control of sexuality and reproduction is really at the root cause of why girls are entered into child marriages. And desire to have a space to explore sexuality is also one of the core reasons why girls may self-initiate marriages. So without reproductive rights, married girls are obviously at risk of significant harm, and this, you know, includes maternal mortality and morbidity, which was raised, but also risks of unsafe abortion, early frequent unintended pregnancy, obstetric fistula, like the morbidities, STIs, and also, of course, heightened vulnerability to violence. And married girls also face all of these risks, right, in particular. And then without reproductive rights, child marriage can also be seen as more likely because unintended pregnancies can also lead to pressure on unmarried girls to get married.
Sorry, I just want to say that I'll translate after you.
Sorry,
speak.
Yes.
So I'll do that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll just translate.
Okay. And also ensuring access to reproductive rights is actually essential to ensuring women and girls equality, which, you know, as we know, the low status of women and girls and the discrimination that women and girls face is also a reason why they are married young. So barriers to reproductive rights really implicitly and explicitly promote the idea that women's and girls' autonomy should not be respected. So this was actually something that was discussed in the Justice Patil Commission report, which called for the state to take measures to ensure that all girl children receive holistic health care and protection, including preventative and curative services, covering their health at all ages, including reproductive health information and services. And that report talks about a lot of commitments that have been made by the government over the years to ensure these services. So, you know, within this, I think that there are like four major proposals that I would suggest. One would be around engagement with the health ministry, as the health department, rather, as was raised by others, to monitor and eliminate barriers to maternal health care, including implementation of schemes to ensure safe and legal abortion, and to ensure access to methods of contraceptives needed. The full range of contraceptives. So not just to limit the number of pregnancies, like sterilization, but also to delay time, space pregnancies. And so some questions that I have for all of you is, you know, how that we know, I think that the schemes, from my understanding, have now, the ones that used to exclude under 18 now do include under 18-year-olds. But are girls actually able to access these maternal health schemes and the benefits that they should be availing of underneath those schemes? A second question I have is around adolescent access to contraceptives and if they actually are able to access and what's creating barriers. And I also wanted to just echo the two recommendations that were made on training of A&Ms and ASHAs around reproductive rights, specifically for adolescents and reproductive health needs. And also on increasing the awareness of providers, which I thought was also such an important point, and also on data, which was also a very important point on maternal mortality for adolescents. So those are some questions. On POCSO, I'm going to leave it mostly to you, but I will echo that I think that we should really look at how criminalization under a consensual adolescent sexual activity under POCSO is impacting child marriage. And also specifically at how it's impacting adolescents' ability to access reproductive health care, because even, you know, for married girls as well, it still is creating barriers. And, you know, the law could actually be applied across all reproductive health services, so not just abortion, but also contraception, maternal health care, which is obviously also problematic. And then the third is the third recommendation, I guess, I'll stop at three, is on comprehensive sexuality education. And, you know, the Justice Patel Commission report actually has like quite a few paragraphs about this and the real need to ensure the psychological and health needs of adolescent girls, and that that prevention as well as addressing risks from child marriage can be done and accomplished through, or helped through, comprehensive sexuality education. And so I also wanted to think about how we could increase government accountability for the guarantees that already exist for CSE in existing policies, or to strengthen those obligations. So I'll stop there, especially with the translation.
So our mainly sexual reproductive rights mele focus maartta idru. So now child marriage bagge nolidre idu mahile avarge minor girls ge sexual reproductive rights access hege aagta ide. So that is what she raised. Matte idu monitoring nu hege aagta ide. So our child marriage aagadre yen avarge reproductive rights to risks yen ide. So risks tumba ide, there are forced sex, the risk ide, early pregnancy aagta ide, maternal mortality, bere diseases like obstetric fistula and all other connected complications, STDs, HIV, mate bere taradu himse dunu risks ide child marriage alli. So unsafe abortions nu aagta ide. So reproductive rights namge access maadbekandre Shivraj Patil committee also recommended idu reproductive rights the risks yenide avaru detail ag recommendations maadidare our recommendations are avaru helidare minor girls within marriage avarge safe abortion access irbeko avarge contraceptives access irbeko so idella namge implement maadbekandre ನಮಗೆ ಅವ್ರ ರೆಕಮೆಂಡೇಷನ್ ಏನಿದೆ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಎಂಗೇಜ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಸೊ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇಂದ ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾನಿಟ್ರಿಂಗ್ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅವ್ರು ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಸೇಫ್ ಲೀಗಲ್ ಅಬಾರ್ಷನ್ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಸಿಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಇದು ಮೆಟರ್ನಲ್ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಸ್ಕೀಮ್ಸ್ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸೊ ದೀ ಸ್ಕೀಮ್ಸ್ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಅವೈಲಬಲ್ ಇದೆ ಅವರಿಲ್ಲ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಸೆಪ್ಟಿವ್ ಮೆಥಡ್ಸ್ contraceptive methods ella tarad contraceptives available irbeko so what is happening is there monitoring or not so idella monitoring maadbekandre idu asha workers du new recommendations maadidira so idu asha workers du training haagbeku idella topics bagge so that avurge helak agutte idella schemes avurge sikta ide idella benefits avurge sikta ide matte karnatakadalli bere ella risks ದು ಏನಿದೆ ಹೈ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ರಿಲೇಟೆಡ್ ರಿಸ್ಕ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸೊ ಈ ಥರ ಸೊ ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಐ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಸೇ ದಟ್ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಮೆಟರ್ನಲ್ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಸ್ಕೀಮ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಸೆಡ್ ಒಬ್ವಿಯಸ್ಲಿ ಒನ್ ಇಶ್ಯೂ ಇಸ್ ದಟ್ ನನ್ ಆಫ್ ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡೆಡ್ ಫಾರ್ ದೋಸ್ ಅಬವ್ ದೋಸ್ ಅಂಡರ್ 18 ಸೊ ಒಬ್ವಿಯಸ್ಲಿ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಅ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡೆಡ್ ಆಸ್ 19 ಸೊ ಮತ್ತು ಪಾಕ್ಸೋ ಜೊತೆಗೇನು ಪಾಕ್ಸೋ ಕ್ರಿಮಿನಲೈಸೇಷನಿಂದ ಚೈಲ್ಡ್ ಮ್ಯಾರೇಜ್ ಅವ್ರ ಪಿ ಸಿ ಎಮ್ ಎ ಮೇಲೆ ಏನು ಇಂಪ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ಇದೆ ಸೊ ಅದನ್ನು ಅವರು ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ರೇಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದರು ಬಟ್ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಈ ಮೈನರ್ ಗರ್ಲ್ಸ್ಗೆ ರೀಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಟಿವ್ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಕೇರ್ ಹೇಗೆ ಸಿಗಬೇಕು ಹೌ ಡು ದೇ ಗೆಟ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಸೆಸ್ ಟು ಇಟ್ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ರಿಲೇಟೆಡ್ ಕೇರ್ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ಡಿಲೇ ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕೇನು ಕಾಂಟ್ರಸೆಪ್ಟಿವ್ಸ್ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಸೆಸ್ ಇರಬೇಕು ಸೊ ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ಇಶ್ಯೂಸ್ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಹೇಗೆ ನಾವು ಗ್ಯಾರಂಟಿ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು ಹೇಗೆ ಮಾನಿಟ್ರಿಂಗ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ಅವರು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕ್ಲಿಯರಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಿ
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಎವ್ರಿಬಡಿ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಜೈನಾ ಫಾರ್ ದಿಸ್ ಆಪರ್ಚುನಿಟಿ ಟು ಸ್ಪೀಕ್ ಟು ಯು ಅ ಡಿಸ್ಅಡ್ವಾಂಟೇಜ್ ಆಫ್ ಕಮಿಂಗ್ ಎಟ್ ದಿ ಎಂಡ್ ಇಸ್ ಎವ್ರಿಬಡಿ ಸೆಡ್ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ನೀಡ್ಸ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಸೆಡ್ ಬಟ್ ದಿ ಅಡ್ವಾಂಟೇಜ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ದಟ್ ಯು ಗೆಟ್ ಟು ಟೈ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ ಹೋಪ್ಫುಲಿ ಸೊ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ವಾಟ್ ವಿ ರೆಕಗ್ನೈಸ್ ಸಿನ್ಸ್ ದ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ದಟ್ ಚೈಲ್ಡ್ ಮ್ಯಾರೇಜ್ ಈಸ್ ಅ ವೈಲೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪೊಲಿಟಿಕಲ್ ರೈಟ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಸ್ಪೋಕನ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ you know how the right to physical integrity is affected bodily autonomy privacy but it is also a violation of economic social and cultural rights and why I say this is important is because we have so far looked at child marriage only within the protection framework we recognize it as falling within child protection and through the morning what we've seen is said is we need convergence we need to look at it beyond an issue of child protection the limitation of looking at it just as a child protection is as an issue is that there is over reliance on the criminal justice system we feel that the answers lie in enforcing the offences enforcing the penalties under the PCMA act and somewhere we ignore the fact that the criminal justice system has failed to deliver not just you know, in laws relating to children, but even be it laws relating to women, or just in general to anybody who's approached the criminal justice system. So we are not taking into account the limitations of the criminal justice system in offering justice to victims of human rights violations. In with respect to data on child marriage, this is Crime in India 2016, the conviction for child under PCMA was 14.7% and the pendency was 93.4%. So most of these cases don't even reach the court. What you said, you know, it takes anywhere between... Correct. So this is under PCMA. Yeah. Will not even get there. Yeah. So that over-reliance has to stop. So even when we say that what is stopping the implementation and enforcement of the act is that, you know, the duty bearers, there is no penalty for them. How many police officers are charged under the IPC for committing custodial rape? Even if they are charged, how many of them end up in conviction? We have enough number of penalties for, you know, government officials not doing what they're supposed to do. None of those provisions are enforced. So I feel we have to stop asking for those kind of remedies in law, because even if you get them, we'll be happy we've gotten them, but on the ground, they don't shift anything at all. So one has to question the kind of, you know, what are we looking to the law for? So in terms of the legal framework, we check all the boxes. Internationally, they say you should have a minimum age for child marriage. We have it. They say you should outlaw child marriage of any kind, and Karnataka has gone ahead and done that, said it's void ab initio. So we've checked all the boxes in terms of having a law. But that alone will not help us eradicate or even eliminate child marriage or minimize it. And here I would like to draw your attention to a study in based on 10 African countries, because child marriage is a huge problem in Africa too. So it's good to see how African countries have dealt with it. And this is a study by the Inter-Parliamentary Union. They've looked at 10 African countries, 5 with high incidence of child marriage and 5 with low incidence of child marriage, and looked at their legal frameworks. So some of the conclusions they drew were that in these 10 countries, there was nothing to show that the legal framework contributed to the reduction of the number of cases of child marriage. So some of these countries with the highest, in fact, the countries with the best legal framework had the highest rate of child marriage. So other than the fact that the government made it very clear that child marriage is not acceptable to us, on the ground, it made no difference. Instead, they said what reduced child marriage was education for girls, community outreach programs. So they said more than the law, it was this that worked. This report is also very interesting because it cites the work of this famous American political scientist called Jerry McKee. And he says, and he's worked on female genital mutilation, which is again a very big problem in Africa, a harmful traditional practice, as well as foot binding in China. And he says, criminalization fails when there is no social norm of legal obedience, when a new legal norm is too far from a current social norm, or both. When a new legal norm is too far from a current social norm, law enforcement personnel have reasons not to enforce and citizens have reasons to disobey. And through the morning, what we've been hearing, like the case that you shared, I think, where you said the entire community went out of its way to ensure that it is not detected. And that's where we have to figure out what in our intervention are we doing to target that. Yes, you can rescue that one child in some way possible, bring her to CWC, file a case, but that's one case. You're not going to change the way the community thinks. The community will still think they're wronged. And here I've seen sympathy lies more with the offender than with the victim. So if you are to file a case, they will say, okay, if we put the parents behind the bar, the child is vulnerable. If you put the husband behind the bar, they'll say, now who's going to look after her? She's pregnant. So there is very little sympathy for the child here. There's sympathy for everybody else around her, because we feel her safety is going to be ensured by them. She's going to be protected by them. So which is why our law is not working. So even if you go to the cop and you file an FI, even the cop doesn't believe this case should be filed, which is why they're let off just with a bond. Because nobody feels the response lies in penal processes. So that's the question we have to ask ourselves, then what will work? And here, there's a very interesting report by Huck Center for Child Rights, which has worked in 3 states in India, Rajasthan, Telangana, West Bengal. High incidences of child marriage. And yes, we spoke about the 3 P's in the morning. They looked at 3 S's. They said self, society, and state. So they said, if you work on empowering the self, you will mobilize the society, and that in turn will impose accountability on the state. So what they did was they organized the girls in these select districts of the three states that they were working in, created adolescent girls groups. What Ashika also spoke about. You have to change, you have to challenge the stereotype, the harmful gender stereotypes that is there among children, especially both boys and girls. And that's what they did. So they focused on girls, told them there are alternatives outside of marriage. And you know, there's more to you than just getting married. And they worked with the community. So you're across the board, religious leaders, political leaders, everybody. So, and as an outcome, what they measured, they found that the number of registered marriages increased. Imams and purohits refused to solemnize marriages when the children, when they were children or without birth certificate. So if you work with a community, that's the only way of resolving this. We cannot alienate the community by saying we are now going to punish everybody who's not reported it. I mean, look at mandatory reporting under POC. So there are many of us in this room who don't believe in mandatory reporting. It's in law. And we are violating the law because we don't believe that that law is right. And that's the same with child marriage. So we have to understand the way in which that their thought process is working, because they don't think it's wrong. So how do we get them to that space where they realize that, okay, this is why it is wrong, and not because you're going to be punished. So a more positive way of approaching it is what I would think is necessary. Also, CEDAW, Article 5, which requires India to challenge all these stereotypical messages that are there to promote gender equality. And here, the schemes also are important. There are many schemes in India where a girl is given money, like a family is given money to ensure that she's studying till the age of 18, and then she gets that money when she's 18, and the money is used immediately to organize the wedding. So again, what are we doing? You know, we're saying that, okay, till it's okay for you to get married at 18. And that's not something we should be endorsing either. So a little thought needs to go into what are the schemes that we are asking for, and what is the message that we are giving, that, you know, okay, delay it till this point, and after that you do what you like. So I think Ashika and you also said that in terms of creating skill building opportunities, and there are not many children in school either. So yes, keep them in school as long as possible, but there have to be alternatives for children who are outside of school. The budget is very important. India's budget for child protection has successively reduced. It's now 3.24% of the union budget. So how much of this budget is going towards prevention? You know, so because all of this is very resource intensive. Whatever we are saying is resource intensive. So how much percentage of the Karnataka government's budget is going to go towards these prevention and community strengthening processes? I also feel like through the morning we've been hearing and we've been speaking about awareness raising, but we have to look at the community beyond a target of awareness. The content of awareness. So where are we strengthening the community measures? Because they are right there. We forget it, we are not going to get dedicated child marriage prohibition officers. It's not going to happen. Look at the JJ system. It's been 19 years, our JJ system is barely functioning, right? So let's forget that we're going to get these dedicated offices. It's a distant dream. We have to work with what we have, who we have. So then how do you operationalize the village child level protection committee? Whoever is there at that local level, be it the school. Yes, it's very good that the headmaster is recognized as a child marriage prohibition officer, because who better than the headmaster will be there to identify, okay, this kid is not coming to school. So yes, we should be happy that we have the headmaster as a CMPO. But now work with that headmaster and help the headmaster realize what needs to be done. So that's one thing. Now, birth registration. It's very well to say that everybody should ask for a birth certificate. There is a huge gulf between birth registration and birth certification. So how are we going to bridge that gap? There are many children who don't have a birth certificate. And even these school certificates, sometimes they're not there. Or at least in a court of law, those school certificates are not admitted as is. You have to examine the person who made the certificate. That person has to say on what basis that certificate was made. The family turns hostile. So this is how it plays out in court, we all know. They will always turn hostile on the point of age. So again, it goes back to, you know, what are the things that we are relying on for the system to work? Everything is flawed. And along the way, even if you have that FIR, it's not necessarily going to give you the conviction. In terms of evidence-based research, data is extremely crucial. But I also feel that what is important is what works. Can we have a study on what works? Because of the districts in Karnataka, there are some districts that are more vulnerable than others. Child marriage is higher in certain districts in North Karnataka compared to others. And the factors may be different for each district. So it is important to understand what is it that is sustaining the vulnerability in this particular district compared to the others. Because only then can you design a prevention and intervention program. The last thing I want to say is in terms of the POCSO Act, and this is the unintended consequence of over-criminalization. So you say, yes, every child has to be protected, everyone below the age of 18, no one can have sex. What happens is when a girl with mental illness walks into NIMHANS with her, you know, in-laws and her husband who brought her there, and the doctor knows, yes, there is POCSO, I have to report it, but I also know if I report it, this girl is not going to come back. They're not going to bring her to me, and this girl is in urgent need of treatment. So what is my duty? Am I responding as a therapeutic, you know, doctor, or am I just getting into this whole aspect of reporting and informing the police that here's a case of child marriage and POCSO? So we really have to question, when you said access to sexual and reproductive health, it is a very critical concern when you read it along with POCSO. Because with this reporting, as you said, it's abortion, it's contraception, it's maternal care, mental health, all of these things get affected. So the minute you walk in and they know you're married, they have to report. So then what are the chances of this child coming back to access that health care? So that's all I have to say.
A very thought-provoking presentation. But I still believe that law has a role to play. I agree that law, to what extent to be used for criminalization purpose, but I believe that the law is not passed with the purpose of criminalization. It's for prevention. And all the stakeholders, the kind of responsibility that they are supposed to perform, they are not doing it. And that's why a thought came in, like, can we punish them to make them work? Some kind of accountability, if it's there, then in that case, that's enough. But then all these stakeholders really need to perform their own work. So we can build the strategies in terms of how to make them work, all the stakeholders. I mean, every point that you have raised against it, I understand that it is for making people aware in terms of how to make use of law in a proper direction. I'm sure you are not arguing that let's cap the law. No, because these kinds of arguments I had criticized very severely in my book also. This sitting judge of the Rajasthan High Court, law is not going to do anything. It's the custom which is rooted in 1,000 years, and then I felt like why the judge has taken the constitutional oath and is in his chair. He should be removed out from there. So had you been there, probably you would have supported the judge. But I think we need to understand the role of the law. Without the law, we could not have argued any of these things. So let's understand the situations, and particularly for that matter, wherever the amendments are earnestly required in terms of stopping child marriages, we really need to think in terms of, like, the one argument that everybody is making here, adolescent sexual activity, how are we going to address that? And I think this suggestion was given to Verma committee by quite a few organizations. Even my college, actually I was responsible for that. We had submitted a report to the, and actually drafting of the law, how it should be, where you need to recognize, it's an exceptional chapter, which is to be created in terms of recognizing the adolescent sexual activity, and then taking it out from the purview of either POCSO or, for that matter, within the criminal law framework. So criminalization is to be used as a last resort, and maybe, you know, like, to some extent, deterrent effect. Like, when you say one case of community, I argue the reverse way. One case from community, and community gets a lesson, and they will think twice again to engage into those practices. All the hidden agenda which that community is using, like abortion or hiding the child, not bringing her in public places. So even for that matter, we need to address the issue in different way. I always say, maybe in previous consultations also, I said that I'm waiting for one girl child approaching me, and then I put all the cases under the PCMA under Section 12. Child marriage, all child marriages are without consent, because legally she cannot give consent. So all child marriages are forced child marriages. and therefore all forced child marriages are void under the current PCMA without referring even to Karnataka Amendment. So on that background, if you declare the child marriage as a void, so when community awareness that you are talking about, then I understand that why child marriage is bad, we definitely need to have a rubric and then going to the community and telling them. Because I know in Maharashtra, when I go to rural area and talk to women, then those women do say, ye toh hamara naseeb hai, fate hai. That's why the girl died during the... So I need to tell her, no, it's not her fate, it is you who are responsible for this. And then I think, maybe, I'm saying it now a little emotionally, but putting them on the guilt complex, they could have saved the life of that girl child, might help us in creating, building more community awareness. So I think all that points you have said, along with the law, if jointly we can do the work, but the point and the session in which it's criminalization which is being focused, I'm sure none of us is very keen on using the law for the purpose of criminalization, but it is for the sake of the other thing there.
I'd like everyone's thoughts on this, particularly two particular points. One, that under abortion law, a minor has to get consent from the guardian. That is one of the main problems I've seen, because there's a big overlap between all the laws. Now with Karnataka making it void also, how does it practically work? And second, most of the cases of abortions that go to court, meaning directly go to High Court or Supreme Court, are abortions where the girl child is not getting the abortion done because she's past the 20-week limit. So how do we address that also? Mostly in the cases, they're minors. So we need to look at these two points, and I'd like all of your thoughts on that.
Framework, because ultimately, I think we have to, there is still a government obligation, right, to address child marriage and address the violations of rights. So I think that the accountability still has to be there. I think the question of the role of the law is that law can actually be one way to bring about that government accountability and to create, and as an advocacy tool, like as a way to move forward with articulating the obligations. So for example, we talk about education and the root causes, and that perhaps law's role is actually, you know, our role as lawyers is to be holding governments accountable to ensuring education and thinking of how we do that. And same, you know, with comprehensive sexuality education or, you know, things like that. I feel like that really resonates to me as one of the key roles of law in this type of issue. So that was just one point. On the post 20 week cases, you know, I've reviewed many of those cases. I know you've also looked at them. In most of them, I don't think I see it's not usually child marriage, but it's definitely the definition of rape under POCSO. So I mean, it's framed as rape when it's a minor, like full stop, basically. And in those cases, I think the perspective that I have seen has been actually very much ignoring the health of the minor almost altogether, that it's not really about that. It's about gestational age of the fetus, and then it's about perhaps what she has suffered already, but it's not, if we don't terminate, will she face any harm? They usually ignore that whole component. So I think and that's where you see a lot of really inconsistent decisions and you know, not very strong decisions. And we actually were just at the Ministry of Health yesterday talking about this issue, and you know, it basically sounds like, you know, unless amendments are happening, there's nothing that's going to happen, that they are fine with the system of judicial authorization, which is really problematic.
Like talking about the abortions, no? So whenever it's not as per the law, then you have to refer to the court is the first thing. I have heard that the government of Karnataka is bringing out some guidelines in this regard, wherein a board consisting of 9 different gynecologist, psychiatrist, and I don't know, the list of people is all encompassing. I don't know how you'll find all those people at the taluk block level, I don't know. A lot of, yeah, district level maybe. So the guidelines are going to be there. Whether it's going to be practical on the ground, time will tell.
I wanted to kind of respond to Swagata. You know, I mean, in one way, I agree with what you said, especially in the context of the PCMA. And if you expand it to all women-related laws, you know, while I still support the implementation of the law, I do understand what you're saying, because basically people don't think child marriages are wrong. So how much ever you may want to implement the law, nobody will implement it. The CMPO doesn't think it's a problem. That is why the CMPO is not vigilant. The police doesn't think it's a problem. The family doesn't think it's a problem. That boy doesn't think it's a problem. The girl doesn't think it's a problem. Nobody thinks it's a problem. Even the court, exactly. Even the court doesn't think it's a problem. So that is the biggest hurdle in implementation of the PCMA and or the void amendment. Today, even if you speak to people saying it's void, they don't care. They don't care because they don't believe in that law. And if you see, even in domestic violence, it's the same. We are going, and every law against women's, for protection of women, that's sexual harassment. Every case of sexual harassment which is filed, where there is a punishment given by the ICC, is challenged in the High Court. High Court sets it aside. Because the court doesn't think that these poor men should be punished for one small mistake they did. So we are losing sexual harassment cases, domestic violence cases, judges, protection officers don't think domestic violence. So the problem is all cases of violence against women, nobody thinks it's a problem. So it's not just PCMA. And how do we, and I think the only way we have to work on is putting the issue of women's rights, women's equality, girls' equality at the forefront, because we can't say, I mean, I understand why, because I see it. But then we have to make these laws work by ensuring that we respect women's and girls' equality. That is the big challenge, because nobody cares about it. You know, nobody thinks it's wrong. That, and so implementation is always going to be a challenge.
I agree with Swagata on 2-3 main things, but I think the attitude change will come only through working with them and through positive examples, which are very rare to see. Many, more than often, we try to use the negative incentive part rather than the positive examples, which need to be increased. And if somebody sees 2-3 girls from their village doing very well, then I don't think parents will think that the child is a burden. The child has not been given an opportunity even to study or come up in life. So she stays a burden. So I think that positive part has to be increased some way or the other. That's very important. And the other thing I wanted to say was, what do you stop with? I wanted to say. Gender sense. I think many a times we are looking at all these issues in a very isolated fashion. When we look at this as part of gender sensitization, and I think more things will work because we have to work more with men also. Very often all our awareness is going for women or girls, but then men also are part and parcel of this process, and many a times they are the decision makers, but hardly we work with them. So that's where I think the issues lie. We have to work more and more with men and boys, along with girls and women.
Quickly respond. I think you summed up completely what I was trying to say. I'm not as radical as saying, like, you know, let's do away with the laws completely. But yes, law is a tool for advocacy, and that's my concern was stemming from the fact that, you know, what I've been hearing through the morning, and what I've seen in POCSO. Whenever you feel the law is not working, your response is to enhance penalty. That's the easiest thing to do because that's the lowest hanging fruit. It's easy to target one offender versus targeting the community and saying, how do you get the community to confirm? So that was where my fear was stemming from. The second was also in terms of... I'll just complete this argument. The other was in terms of resource, because we know resource is limited. So how much of your resource would you spend on ensuring implementation of the act versus focusing, and of course prevention is part of the act, versus strengthening community and ensuring that the prevention aspect of the act is, you know, is strengthened further. So yeah, you can respond. Then I have something.
Well, what I feel is, whenever women's movement has asked for any law, the legislators are very keen on giving it. You want this? You want this? Yeah. Tick, 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 without meaning it for implementation, without having any kind of budget. So the legislators are very smart, which is again a very male-dominated arena. So that's the problem. So we need to educate even them for that matter, like, and including Supreme Court judges. When they give the kind of statements, like 498 is being misused, they should come and attend our classes. I mean it. In the law colleges, when we teach 498A, they should come and attend the classes. Then they will understand what 498A is. So it's an understanding of all the stakeholders, right from the top level judges till everyone who is responsible under the act. We need to really sensitize them. So that's what I just wanted to add.
I wanted to just share a positive example, because you're so right, we never ever talk about the good things. And again, Huck's example of working in Rajasthan, where they've got these girls playing football, wearing t-shirts and, you know, shorts. Huge for a community where, you know, especially in Rajasthan, where girls cannot dress like that. So it's so empowering, and that's one of the ways of, you know, creating value for the girls themselves, for the community, to see them beyond just, you know, their identity of a girl who needs to get married. So really worth looking at what they've been doing in these three states, because there are positive examples there. With respect to your question on MTP, and there was a very complex case. I know Ashika handled it, and I recall assisting the CWC in a limited way. If I can share it, Ashika, is it okay? So there was a girl who was married to her uncle, pregnant, wanted to opt out of that marriage, wanted to abort that baby. So long story short, she was produced before the CWC. Parents and her husband were all arrested. So now who's going to give, consent for that termination? So huge turmoil, and then reading of the JJ Act to convince the CWC that let the superintendent of the child care institution be the guardian for this purpose. And yeah, correct. So first was convincing CWC that you can pass the order, and then the biggest hurdle, when we talk about people in the system not wanting to let the law be applied, huge resistance on the part of the superintendent, who felt this marriage needs to be preserved, who felt this baby should not be terminated. And till the last minute, there was drama outside the hospital with this girl's brother coming in with a letter saying, I am the guardian and I do not give consent for the MTP. And this girl has already been induced. But that tells us the kind of barriers that we have. So you have a CWC who's passed that order, you've not designated somebody. It's the superintendent who called that girl's brother and asked him to come to the hospital to stop that termination, because she still felt that marriage, you know, should continue. So yeah, that's how it works on the ground. Yeah, and the 20-week limit, the MTP guidelines, there's some of us who've been working on it, and that notification has already come, where they've said at the district level they have to have this medical board that will then determine.
No, just to respond to what Dr. Jaya said in response to Swagata's presentation, I completely endorse what Swagata says. I do see value in what you say also, ma'am, because we've seen examples where we've pulled up a family under the PCMA Act, and the entire community actually sat up and actually saw, because this family was pulled up under the Act. And an awareness program was created, and they actually welcomed that entire awareness program. In fact, it was handled by Childline, if I remember. And the entire community now realizes that, you know, they need to be watchful. Yes, intervention with regard to prevention needs to happen at grassroots level. But if we do not have laws, we cannot curtail or cannot work on any of these issues completely. It has to work on hand in hand. So there's not absence of one and completely, you know, the presence of one may not work. We need both to work hand in hand. And with regard to reproductive health and sexual rights, I think India has a lot to do on that front. We don't talk about it in schools. We hesitate to talk about it at home. And children are left wondering what to do, end up exploring, which ends up getting them to take decisions that are not okay for them, not in the perspective of their rights per se, but at least consequentially, it's very detrimental to them because of, again, laws that are there that are not adequately supporting their exploration. So yeah, so all these things have to work in tandem. That's what we have to see. Yeah.
Again, adding on to that, so there are two things, right? One, where the law is rendered useless because the society is not ready for it or society is unwilling to take it up. And second is where the law is in fact harming the people who it is supposed to benefit. Like here, consenting adults indulging in sexual activity, and second is you are putting the girl child through emotional trauma because the community does not expose her outside. So how the challenge is, how do we ensure that the law does not do the latter? For the former, we can say that, okay, you can have your civil society organizations work with the community, but how do we ensure that the wordings in the law do not end up harming the people it is supposed to benefit? And that is where I think we need to look at, you know, ensuring that the law is framed correctly. How do we do that?
ನನಗೆ ಅನಿಸಿದ ಕೆಲವೊಂದು ಮೇಡಮ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ನಮಗೆ ಮೂರು ಹಂತಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಪ್ರಿವೆನ್ಷನ್, ಪ್ರಾಸಿಕ್ಯೂಷನ್, ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಮೂರೂ ಸಹ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಈಕ್ವಲ್ ಪ್ರಿಯಾರಿಟಿ ಕೊಡಲೇಬೇಕಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ. ಸೊ ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ನಮಗೆ ನಾವು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಗೌರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳುವಾಗ ಮೇಡಮ್ ನೆನಪಿಸ್ತಿದ್ರು. ಸೊ ಬೆಳಗ್ಗೆ ಸಹ ನಾವು ನೆನಪಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿ, ಒಂದು ಒಂದು ದಿವಸದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಐದಾರು ಕಾನೂನುಗಳನ್ನು ಗಂಟೆಗೊಂದಿಷ್ಟು ಕಾನೂನು ನಾವು ಮಾಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ಸ್, ಅಥವಾ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಟಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋದ್ವಿ ನಾವು ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳೋದಲ್ಲ. ಬಟ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಾಗಿ ಯಾಕೆ ಇದು ಅಪರಾಧ ಅಥವಾ ಯಾಕೆ ಹೆಣ್ಮಕ್ಳಿಗೆ ಇದು ತೊಂದರೆ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅನ್ನೋ ಸೆನ್ಸಿಟೈಸೇಷನ್ ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಟಿಗೆ. ಸೊ ಅದನ್ನು ಫೋಕಸ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಎಡುತ್ತಿರೋದು ಅಂತ ಒಂದು. ಎರಡನೇದು ನಮಗೆ ಅಕೌಂಟಬಿಲಿಟಿ ಇಲ್ಲದೇ ಹೋಗಿಬಿಟ್ರೆ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಈಗಲೂ ಹೇಳಬೇಕಂದ್ರೆ ನಮಗೆ ಈಗಲೂ ಕಾನೂನು ಭಯ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಸೊ ಯಾರು ಏನು ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು ನಡೆಯುತ್ತೆ, ಮಹಿಳೆಯರನ್ನ ಯಾರು ಹಿಂಸೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು ನಾವು ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಬರ್ತೀವಿ. ಸೊ ಇದೇ ರೀತಿ ಮನೋಭಾವನೆ ಇದ್ದಾಗ ನಮಗೆ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಬೇಕಾಗಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು ಅಕೌಂಟಬಿಲಿಟಿನೂ ಬೇಕು, ಮತ್ತು ಆ್ಯಟಿಟ್ಯೂಡ್ ಚೇಂಜ್ ಆಗಬೇಕು. ಮತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ಮತ್ತೆ ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಂಗ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಿ, ರೀಸೆಂಟಾಗಿ ನಾನೊಂದು ಅವೇರ್ನೆಸ್ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗಿದ್ದಾಗ ಸೊ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಚೈಲ್ಡ್ ಮ್ಯಾರೇಜ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆನೇ ಹೇಳಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು. ಸೊ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಂಥವರಲ್ಲಿ ಸುಮಾರು ಜನ, ಒಂದು 95% ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು, ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಮಹಿಳೆಯರೇ ಇದ್ದಿದ್ದು. ಸೊ ಯಾಕೆ ನಿಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾರು ಜೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂದರೆ, ಇನ್ನೇನು ಸೆಷನ್ ಶುರು ಮಾಡೋಷ್ಟರಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದ ಮೂರು ಜನರಲ್ಲಿ ಒಬ್ಬರು ಎದ್ದು ಹೋದರು. ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಅದು ಮಹಿಳೆಯರ ವಿಚಾರ. ಸೊ ಹೆಣ್ಮಕ್ಳ ವಿಚಾರ ಅಂದರೆ ಹೆಣ್ಮಕ್ಳಿಗೆ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಹೇಳಬೇಕು, ಮಕ್ಕಳಂದರೆ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಹೇಳಬೇಕು. ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಾಗಿ ಅದು ಹೋಗಬೇಕಾಗಿರೋದು ಅವರ ಮನಸ್ಸುಗಳಿಗೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಎಡುತ್ತಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ಅದನ್ನು ಫೋಕಸ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಅದನ್ನು ಪ್ಲಾನಿಂಗಲ್ಲಿ ತರಬೇಕು. ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ನಮ್ಮ CMPOಗಳಾಗಲಿ, ಪೊಲೀಸ್ ಆಗಲಿ, ಯಾರೇ ಆದರೂ ಅವರುಗಳು ತಪ್ಪು ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಂದರೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಹೇಳೋರು ಯಾರು, ಅವರ ಜವಾಬ್ದಾರಿಗಳನ್ನು ಮತ್ತೆ ಎಚ್ಚರಿಸೋರು ಯಾರು, ಅದರ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆಯಲ್ಲೂ ಕೆಲಸಗಳಾಗಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ನನ್ನೊಂದು ಅನಿಸಿಕೆದು.
ಯು ನೋ, ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನಿಂಗ್, but the way trainings happen is really not ideal at all, where, you know, different, like in one day there'll be like 5 laws that would be addressed and each law would just get 1 hour each, and so hardly any training is done in that hour. It's not important that you, I mean, it's not enough that you just say what the law is, but you have to explain why the child marriage is prohibited or why the law is made. That is not given. So therefore the issue, idea of gender equality, etc., is never conveyed. And also what she said is that when she went for one of the trainings, I think to some government, it was some government program and training, in the room about 95% of them were all women. And then when she asked where are the men, they said there were some 3 men and they walked out. So all the men feel that this is a women's issue. So the men are never there part of the training, and in fact we have to train police officers and CMPOs and all for this, but the training never reaches them. So she raised many of these problems in the law.
I just want to add on to what Swagata ma'am was trying to say. I mean, I think so, looking at the data, what law has been doing for last 40 years, it's a good time to reanalyze. If data numbers don't lie, and these are the numbers we somehow are forced to believe in. So even at looking at legislative demands that we have asked from our own governments and state bodies, and if it's not working, maybe law has to become creative. And I think so, most of us, there's this tendency, even in the criminal justice system, there is a punitive and there's a non-punitive part of it also, where we can, I mean, if, for example, give an example of adolescent-friendly health clinics. It's a great institutional structure which has a backing of government, where a lot of problems can be solved. It's a great preventive measure, where a young person can directly walk in, can talk to a counselor, can talk to a doctor, and can actually prevent a lot of problems. But if we actually go looking for these AFHCs, they don't exist. Or even if you go in, the only thing you're getting is iron tablets. But technically, you're supposed to get contraceptives, you're supposed to get medical counseling, you're supposed to get a lot of counseling happening there. I'm so glad that the issue of budget came in. When we are aware there is a resource crunch and then we don't have money, why don't we, I mean, allocate? And this is where we have to get, I mean, somebody's talked about drafting of laws, right? I mean, if lawyers are sitting there and we, I mean, I think so before even we reach the drafting, even in our demands. I think so it's a good time for us to reinvestigate our demands that we are asking from the final legislation. And instead of just focusing on the punitive part of it, if we can talk about strengthening institutions and also doing an interlinkages of it. So public health system, education system, even social infrastructure. I mean, even if you're talking about shelter homes, and most of us would not send our own people to shelter homes, where are we thinking of sending them then? So, and even failures of all these mechanisms, including ICC, these ICCs are not trained. I mean, we don't have people who are sitting on ICC who want to be in ICC, and there's nobody else who wants to be in ICC. And it's a lot of labor intensive, at the same time, resource intensive practice. So if law can allocate budget, or if we can, even in our law, I mean, final legislation act, can ask for it within the law, I don't know how to go about it. That's a drafting question. That's the legal minds where they can come in. And also, I feel like it's high time we bring in, I mean, lawyers, psychologists, medical professionals, if we are going to take sexual and reproductive health seriously. Because, for example, One Stop Crisis Center is a failure. It's a great idea, but we are trying to implement it. We have money has been spent. We have 42 lakhs building standing there with nobody inside it. And girls have been told that you can go to this One Stop Crisis Center. It's a great place to chill out. It's empty. And money has been spent. This is our taxpayers' money. And that money could have been used for trainings, for actually getting, I mean, I don't blame the JJ bodies, even people sitting inside. There is no salary. I have reached the stage, I've stopped blaming them. Why should they get compassion? Compassion doesn't come now. It doesn't. It's a hard work. So I think so. If that law can pick it up and not just focus on punitive, because after 40 years, if deterrence hasn't worked, maybe it's a good time for us to reinvestigate if how to make law more stronger. Because I believe law is strong. It's just that maybe we're focused so much on deterrence that women want to. I mean, young women are getting into relationships. 16-year-olds are getting into relationships. How do we actually? I mean, even when we're calling them children all the time, a lot of us assume that young girls are not. They are. A lot of girls are. MTP is such a serious case, and most of us, we can't even say examples, because you will be on the other side of the law. But you want to help them, and as lawyers, you don't know how to find loopholes. So if we can, and this is where we have to get creative more than anything.
As Madam said, along with law, see now, Child Marriage Act is more speaks about than penalization than preventive measures. Section 16, C, B, C, D, A, till all section are talking about the preventive aspect. So it is community aspect, everything is covered. And second thing is under RDPR, we have after ICPS comes 2000. So we have a CPC, Child Protection Committee, which the madam has raised. We have failed to strengthen that system. If that system is functional, then all this not necessary. And second, third point is the Makkala Grama Sabha. Karnataka is initiated, but unfortunately, we don't know how functional, how it is qualitative implement, that is the second question. But if you are able to strengthen that Makkala Grama Sabha, CPC and ATC, ATC means Anti-Trafficking Committee at the Gram Panchayat level. This is a three layer is there. To strengthen the committee, no need, I don't know, if in my district, I don't want one child marriage FIR. If I feel like that as a district magistrate, I will strengthen these three. Then no FIR will be there in my district. So this ATC, CPC, Makkala Grama Sabha, CPC under ICPS, which is very nice document and very clear written, whatever people's participation, PPP, everything is there. But unfortunately, nobody is strengthening that, nobody is implementing. Even Makkala Grama Sabha, earlier it is under the government circular. Now after 2015, Grama Swaraj and Panchayat Raj Act, Grama Swaraj and Panchayat Raj, we are running now Grama Swaraj and Panchayat Raj, which is very beautiful. It is a country, in the country, it is the best model. Implementation, it is a big challenge. Under 3H, it is a mandatory for children and women, Grama Sabha, to bring out all this, whatever since morning we are raising, this has to be controlled by the Grama Sabha through CPC. If trafficking issue, there is a big book Gram Panch has to maintain for the migration, Gule, Valase, maintain. They have to issue a card. If my one child going from Koppala to Mangalore, it has to be registered in the panchayat, and they have to issue a card. In Mangalore, in that panchayat or in Nagar Sabha, it has to be registered. He has to be employed in some wherever he want to go.
See, such a mechanism you are failed only through this law. Law is only one part, is very good. We have to do, because in North Karnataka, some of the child marriage reduced in Koppal or Raichur, 10% reduced only because of some cases as filed in the court. Prosecution is not yet come, but still, because of that act, now it is reduction is, we can see. Same thing in the POKSO also. I have visited 13 jail now in Karnataka. All the 13 jail, highest people are inside and under POKSO Act. Yes. See, why? Because now people, not in this group, but in outside, some are selling, because of POKSO Act, rape has been increased. No. Reporting, case, FIR, so many things are there. So like this, it is a both. We cannot know.
I'll just respond to a few things. Yeah, I completely agree with you in terms of accountability. So definitely there has to be some accountability system. What should that be? And I mean, there are disciplinary proceedings also. That's not penal, but there are departmental proceedings that can be initiated if somebody has not acted. And of course, the training, and this is also connected to the fact that we think only women judges are sensitive, only women police officers. No, I'm saying in law. Now we have that. We have saying women police officers will only deal with a girl child, only woman doctor will deal with a girl child. We are not realizing that what is the percentage of women in the police force? What is the percentage of women doctors in the district and the tehsil? So we are asking for things, and therefore we are making it so exclusive that men can walk out of the room and say that, okay, you know, only women need to deal with it because they will have to, they're more sensitive than us. So I think we should also question those demands of ours, which have now made into law. With respect to bills, now all bills should have a financial memorandum. But if you see, all these socially beneficial laws don't have a financial memorandum at all. So which is why JJ Act was never took off. And that's when 2009, they had to bring in the ICPS to support the implementation of the JJ Act. So we have to ensure, at least in Karnataka, there has to be a financial memorandum that is supporting the implementation of this act. And here I remember Ms. Renate Winter, who is the chairperson of the Child Rights Committee, the UN Child Rights Committee, and she asked us, you know, which is the most important ministry for children? And all of us are like, you know, MWCD, education, health. She said, no, finance. Finance ministry is the most important ministry for children. So if you want to do anything, you have to lobby with the finance ministry to ensure that, you know, you get a bigger part of the pie. I completely agree with you. In fact, that was one of the points I had listed for, a village child protection committee. So there is no point creating any new structure. We have to work with the structures that are there, and they're there. So the skeleton of that structure is already there. ICPS provides for it. How do we strengthen it further?
Well, ICPS, there are bulk budget has been sent back.
Yeah.
Which is not used. Though it is 3.2 is there allotted, but still that money also we have not spent in the grassroots level in our district level.